welcome to a brand new Record Club episode of the Jams and Tea podcast, where we spin the jams and spill the tea. And this week, we're going to be talking about the most important band of our era, the voice of a generation. And that voice is the voice of one Mr. Tom DeLonghi.
You see, Jake, America needed Tom DeLonghi. He came along at a moment in time where he was capitalizing on the success of his, definitely his, and definitely not a band that was in any way shaped or directed by any other member. His band, Blink 182, were riding the high of being
my
one of the most culturally
favorite band to sing about wanting to fuck dogs.
Riding the high of the most cultural relevance of that they received at the turn of the century, you know, massive hit singles, massive albums. They were the biggest band in the world, but Tom DeLonghi felt it in his bones. It wasn't enough. See, Tom DeLonghi didn't just want to be the biggest band in the world. Tom DeLonghi wanted to change the world. In 2001, Al-Qaeda terrorists flew airliners into the World Trade Center, forever changing the dynamic of America and the world, and forever ushering into the world a sense of a state of global terror that we have still not fully escaped from in terms of insecurity politically and war-torn shit that's happened, all of that. But Tom DeLonghi is here to unite us all. And he wasn't able to do that in Blink 182 because he was being held back by the chains of the pop punk scene that he existed within. He needed to forge his own path. Every great man has to forge his own path, I think, is the conventional wisdom that we can all agree with. How many side projects must a man walk down before you can call him a man, as Bob Dylan once said? Angels and Airwaves released their debut album, We Don't Need to Whisper, in 2005. A project masterminded, recorded, envisioned, and realized wholly by Tom DeLonghi, with the express goal of essentially changing the world. Tom DeLonghi's aspirations and desires and his sense of possibility absolutely encrusts itself across all of the songs in this album. And you have to understand that, yes, coming off of the back of being in the band that wrote I Want to Fuck a Dog in the Ass, there was a sense of credibility that DeLonghi felt the need to ensure he had in the eyes of the public. And I mean, who is better equipped to make change in the world, to end wars, to fully unite the people? Who is better equipped than the rock star to do those things? The ambassador for peace in the 20th century and beyond, the pop singer. Tom DeLonghi stated himself, I want to change how music is marketed. I want to change how music is made. I want to change how music is delivered. He said of his band, this band contains an inner energy and a spiritual awakening that's kind of magical. And it's so full of positive energy that I think that whoever comes to the shows or listens to the album and wants to become a part of it, it will happen to them. I think it's going to be a sort of magical, organic thing that happens with anybody that is willing to have that kind of feeling in their life. When we were making this record, I remember one night, it was about 2 a.m., and I went into the studio, which was in my house, and it was pitch black. And I put the record on and I listened to it. And I had this overwhelming rush of emotions. I was like, oh my God, this is going to be huge. And I started having these panic attacks, thinking about every country in the world wanting us multiple times. Conquering the globe is a pretty large endeavor. This is the best music made in decades. It is so much more powerful, emotional, and melodic than Blink and Boxcar put together that I am currently shitting my pants.
And he strives to answer one question. What if Blink 182 had reverb? And so, of course, he now has strived to go on to conquer the world so that he could, of course, be ranked 1,328th for the year 2006 on Rate Your Music.
Now, listen, here is my sales pitch. If you've never heard Angels and Airwaves, fear not, because you don't need to listen to Angels and Airwaves. You've heard Angels and Airwaves, even if you don't think you've heard Angels and Airwaves. Here's what I want you to imagine. I want you to imagine U2's eternal, amazing, classic album opening song, Where the Streets Have No Name. I want you to imagine that song right now, a fixture of rock and roll greatness in history. I want you to take away Bono's voice. I want you to take away the Edge's guitar. I want you to just sit in the atmosphere of that song. And then I want you to imagine the guy who sang I Miss You singing over top about how he and he alone has the power to save the world, but you need to trust him and you need to take his hand and you need to follow this love between you and him.
Suck his dick.
Exactly. You know, it seems obvious. The reference point I thought of the most while listening to this week, it's not even U2 or Muse or any of those archetypes that the band is inarguably aping to the nth degree. No, the band I thought of was 30 Seconds to Mars.
Yep. Jesus fucking Christ. Oh my God.
That's right.
Accurate. And what's interesting is that, like, I would argue that Tom DeLonge, I mean, this is not going to surprise anyone, Tom DeLonge is absolutely, undeniably, a more talented and visionary musician than Jared Leto. Yet, it's so funny to me that even though I actually have a good deal of affection for this album, and I think that instrumentally it's got some real backbone to it, it has some good production, it sounds impactful for the most part, and it is led by one of the most enduring singles of its era, The Adventure, a great song that I think still holds up. Despite all of that, this is still really no more distinct from the patchwork of inspirations and broad wallpaper of anthemic stadium rock that 30 Seconds to Mars came to represent in the latter half of the 2000s, and then the mantle, of course, of which Imagine Dragons picked up and modernized for the sound of the 2010s as well. The extent to which you care for or aesthetically enjoy any of these bands will depend on how you feel about the aesthetics of overblown stadium rock at each of these different points in our modern cultural history, the early 2000s, the late 2000s, the 2010s. Of course, it's gotten more synthetic, it's gotten more polished, it's gotten more factory made. And Angels and Airwaves represents, I think, the kind of fulcrum point between the, you know, 90s and 80s era of like proper anthemic stadium rock, where you have that muscular energy, where each performer has an identity and a personality and matters, like U2, of course, the defining example of that. And the sort of anonymous Pro Tools-esque sort of, you know, vaguely patchwork garage band core stadium rock that has emerged to flood the airwaves in the 21st century. And I'm not going to get on my, I'm trying not to sound like Rick Beato here, but it kind of is that sort of dichotomy and dynamic of how this style of music has shifted. And Angels and Airwaves represents like the exact middle ground between this style of music's most insufferable, cloying, and absolutely dreadful tendencies, and this just the echoes of the genuine kind of heart on sleeve, heart and throat glory that bands like U2 represented in the early era, where that stadium rock had a novelty to it and felt like it could change the world, as stupid as that sounds. Angels and Airwaves are right in the middle of those two poles for me. They are desperately, desperately trying to be in the former camp, in the U2 camp, in the glory days classic rock camp. But they are, by virtue of their place in culture, their place in history, and the fundamental fact that this band doesn't have a Bono or a The Edge or an Adam Clayton or a Larry Carlton Jr., the fact that Angels and Airwaves inevitably ends up being in the latter camp, in the Imagine Dragons camp, more or less.
And they certainly don't have a Brian Eno. Instead, they have the guy who produced the first three Ministry albums.
Hey, look, I think the record sounds good. I don't have any real production qualms with this album. Maybe one of you will. That's fine.
I fucking guess.
If he produced those first three Ministry albums, all I know about this album is that it's going to be one thing and one thing only, and that's horny. Horny as hell and ready to plow through you with a big rubber dick on.
It's less horny and more so encouraging other people to be horny for it. It's like, okay, it's Tom DeLonge impassionately intoning that you should feel the will of God go through you to fuck him. Like, you should, the stars in the sky are shining purely to shine on you on that night where you will fuck him.
No, Bill Cosby thought the same thing, but he just spiked water.
Look, so the genre here, just to get it clear, I don't think of it as space rock. I don't think of it as prog rock. I don't think of it as pop punk. I don't think of it as alt rock. I mean, it may be some of all of those things. But how I would best describe this as statutory rape core is exactly what this is.
See? This Bill Cosby.
Leave Cosby out of it, all right?
Come on, this is not a black, this is not a black country New Road review.
We are leaving that Tom DeLonge is in any way comparable to Bill Cosby.
I'm going to Tommy on your Tommy, buddy. I'll bust your balls harder than Hiroshima and Nagasaki number two.
All I'm saying is, this is the kind of music that evokes that archetype that you imagine is written in some form for that purpose. Not necessarily, I'm not going to say Tom DeLonge wants to have sex with a bunch of underage individuals. Maybe he does, maybe he doesn't. The idea is...
And why is that what you said?
The idea is that what that represents, which is Tom DeLonge desperately wanting to be loved. Desperately wanting to be seen as someone who has the power to change the world.
You know,
Tom DeLonge has such a belief in the ineffable power of rock music to actuate change, combined with an ego that would make Billy Corgan look like Gandhi.
You know, I think Tom DeLonge, you could take him more seriously if his name was Tin Dangle.
And the result of that is this record and this project. Jake, so, Morgan, what are your thoughts on We Don't Need to Whisper?
All right, look, my thoughts are not long. Unlike Mr. Tom.
Unlike Mr. Tin Dangle.
The thing is about We Don't Need to Whisper is that, yeah, it's very, you know, this sound is very big, grand, portentous and all of that. But like the people, like, for example, this is a 4-star review on its Rim page. People who take this CD so seriously are jackasses, and the ones who are offended by it are even worse. First of all, if you like, I guarantee you not a single human being alive that has disliked this band or this album has ever once considered taking them seriously. The moment you hear this man's singing voice, if you even decide to try and take it seriously. You have lost the plot. It's gone. I nowhere near did I pretend like I was going to enjoy this without 70 layers of slathered on irony. And honestly, I don't even really get there. The thing is that this gets mileage out of me for being comedic gold. And that, yes, this is essentially like showbiz origin of symmetry era Muse instrumentals, except instead of like, you know, the Benz era Tom York singing it, instead you have the guy who says tonight and here,
where
and
are
every line is so funny. It's backed by this enormous like stadium prog instrumental, and then you just have this wimpy ass whiny man coming on to here singing about how tonight is the night and how all of the nights have been leading up to this night and how important it is and how important it is that you look in his eyes and that you kiss him and that you do it for him and that you do everything for him and that everything is about him and there's look, a war and gifts and machines and they all have to do with something and I don't care about this, any of it.
What you're telling me is that this is very reminiscent of early Coheed and Cambria.
Honestly, yes. It's like if you took out Claudio Sanchez and put in the lead singer of Pup, and without the good qualities that might entail.
No, I'm not running with this comparison. Because Coheed and Cambria, behind their respective instruments, make everyone... Even Adam Willard, who is like, kills it on this album and every Against Me album that he is on. I love Adam Willard. Every member of Coheed makes every member of this band look like idiot children playing a guitar that you could buy at Walmart. I can't run. I just need that known.
No,
someone who might not have heard this album.
It is like if you took back like... It's an album that would be like the proto. This is to Coheed and Cambria what like fucking early Pink Floyd is to Dark Side of the Moon. It's like, sure, you can compare them, but also one of them's gonna look a whole lot better than the other one.
I just want to point out that on the Wikipedia page, the most positive review for this album under the professional rating section is from fucking IGN.
I mean, I get this is 2006 core, like in the sense that I can see the review score on the IGN website, like in my brain, using like they encoded it with HTML. Like the website doesn't look nearly as good as it does. Makes me feel 9. Which is the worst music could possibly... And look, I know I'm making this sound unbearable, and it's not, just because I think the instrumental stuff is generally pretty solid and sounds okay. I mean, it trips over the line into getting okay. It sounds big and occasionally kind of garish, but it's not the worst thing ever. But I mean it when I say that this is fucking, how many songs is this? This is 10 songs. This is basically going up on 50 minutes of nothing but a chuckle session of laughing at Tom DeLonge's silly ass voice. And looking at the album cover of this, which I find way more interesting than the music, lyrics, or endeavors of this band, which...
No, the album cover is great, let's be clear.
It has this Dream Theater font, and then it has like a cube. Just a translucent cube surrounding the Earth, and like I'm just like, is this like a conspiracy theory?
Before time, there was the cube.
This whole thing, as I've hopefully made very clear, is a tribute to one man's ego, under the guise, of course, of wanting to change the world and do all of these different things, which I'm sure on some level Tom believes. You know, that is his motivation, but ultimately it is a monument to ego, as much as 30 Seconds to Mars is a monument to Leto's ego. But I will say that there is something, I don't think that a colossal monument to ego is inherently a negative thing from my standpoint. And I think that here, even though it's not like, you know, a masterpiece in the same way that other colossal monuments to ego, like Melancholy and the Infinite Sadness, for instance, would be classed. It's still a record where that aspect of it, how kind of heavy-handed and pretentious it is, and it is incredibly heavy-handed and pretentious in every single song, is kind of weirdly endearing when it is played the way that it is here, so intensely, with so much gusto, and with so much passion. It's kind of pathetic, but also kind of weirdly respectable in a certain sense. I bend around to kind of respecting the sheer commitment to the just ridiculous excess of this record. And I legitimately, I've listened to it 3 or 4 times this week, and I have not at any point while listening to it wanted to turn it off. It is eminently listenable.
I really question your sanity sometimes. I feel like this podcast is bad for you.
You know, that to me, I think that's a fair review of this album, Riley, because I've heard this album. And, you know, that fourth song...
It's such a
sweet, sweet song. I really love the vocal chemistry on Summer Wine. It's just a really pretty...
It's the vocal chemistry between Tom DeLonge and Tom DeLonge.
Tim Dangle and himself. Yes.
I think The Adventure, as much as, you know, any of those big songs off of records like 1X or any of those terrible sort of like badly aged post-grunge records we've talked about,
album.
I think that song, in as much as any of the best songs in any of those albums, stands up as a really like iconic single of the era and what we would think of when we think of this band. And I don't need to acknowledge the existence of any other Angels and Airwaves albums. This is all you need. This is the distilled idea of the excessive, ambitious, you know, balls to the wall stadium rock band. And I feel like everyone that's come after them has paled in comparison.
Let me tell you what this is. This is your high school dropout San Diego stoner who smokes so much weed to the point where he thinks he is God. And this is the music that this hypothetical being would create. And like listening to you recount his story about sitting down and listening to this album one night, It cleared so many questions I had about this album up for me, because that is the single most I am so blitzed right now story I have ever heard from a creative person. This man got
so stoned
that he listened to his own music and ascended to a higher plane, and with that great power came the great responsibility to save the world. My God, man. Imagine the reefer.
I imagine this album as like a 90s like kind of Don Bluth film, you know, those kind of slightly more intellectual brand of kids film. We've got this like down on his luck, downbeat little guy, and that's Tim Dangle. He's the main character of this film. And so what he does, he's like an orphan, everyone hates him, they say fuck you Tim Dangle, you'll never be anything. And then like the anti-rock devil comes, and the anti-rock devil is like, fuck you Tim Dangle, I'm gonna kill the earth if you don't beat me in a rock contest.
No dancing in my town.
Yeah. And then Tim Dangle, he like spends the film training. He meets Equus the unicorn, the magical drum unicorn, who's like the horn of a unicorn. It comes to a ride symbol, and he can use that to like bash it and fucking kill people. And then there's like Jibberoo the bird, and Jibberoo the bird is a guitar, and he's got like wind guitar powers, and like you, like some of these characters die along the way, and it's very tragic.
And then when he fights the anti-rock devil, he like calls upon the powers of Earth. And like we see shots of like Robert Plant, Chuck Schindler, and Freddie Mercury, you know, all the big rock guys.
They all come through the Avengers portal at the end.
Yeah, they come through
Chuck Schindler.
And then they channel their rainbow crystalline power into Tin Dangle, and he ascends. He grows up like 12 years, and he like looks, he's a fucking adult, and the anti-rock devil's like, how is this possible? And he's shooting like walls of rock at him, and he's just busting through it with his head. He's going like, boom, 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 and his nose starts bleeding. He's looking like Andrew WK, and he's just walking slowly, and then he starts playing the loudest rock song you've ever heard, and he like fucking breaks the sound barrier, and he resets time and undoes the anti-rock devil, saves all his friends, but then he goes back to being a poor fucking orphan. But then no one hates him, but they don't know he saved the universe. He just changed fate, man. He's the fucking greatest person ever. And right now, and you know, this film's been forgotten about, and right now on IGN, some fucking, not IGN, like what's BuzzFeed or something, some hack journalist with a name like Zazzy or some shit is writing an article about how this is like the greatest film of the 90s. And we all hate Zazzy. We know she's full of shit. And then like, yeah, that's what this album is like.
Favorite tracks and ratings, Jake.
I don't know, man. Fucking We Will Rock You, 5 out of 10.
All right. Morgan, your favorite tracks and ratings. My three favorite tracks are Valkyrie Missile, Distraction, and The Adventure. Although I do like Start the Machine as well. I think it's a pretty good closer. My least favorite track is A Little's Enough for sure. And I give the album a 6 out of 10.
So my favorite tracks on here, it's going to be Start the Machine, A Little's Enough, and The Gift. All
your favorite the gift track is definitely not A Little's Enough.
No, that the song gift
blows.
The Gift really gets it really to does. Me, though. That The Gift is really good. You got to give me The Gift.
The Gift by Susan Boyle.
Yeah. And my least favorite song is gonna be Tin Dangle, Tin Dangle, Tin Dangle, Tin Tin Dangle.
Tim Dangle. For years, I've been looking for you. Or any trace of you, and I'm going to find you, Tim. After what your mother did to me, after what your mother did to me, and you were complicit, I will find you. I've scoured every corner of the web, I've scoured every corner of the net just to find any lead, any trace, any breadcrumb of your existence, Tim. And I've got bad news for you, Tim. I finally found something. I finally found something. I'm going to find you.
This is where the contact told me to meet him. Don't see him anywhere.
You. That's right. It is I, Tim Dangle. And you must be the one who has been hunting me for so long now. I don't know what you're getting at or what you're after. But I figure, persistence deserves a little bit of a reward. So why not? You come back to my place, and we can broker some sort of a deal and get this figured out. Because quite frankly, I don't like having vermin like you on my tail. What's the matter? A little shy?
Welcome to my humble abode.
So humble of you to stand all the way up there.
Never mind that. Well, anyways, about this dispute. We will settle this in the only way I see sensible. With a game. A card game. of Magic and Wizards, aka the most popular card game in the world that our whole economy revolves around.
Very well. But what will be the stakes of this matchup?
If you win this match of Magic and Wizards, I will give you whatever information you like. But if I win, you will leave me alone and be put into $10,000 of debt to me.
$10,000? See, I can pay that off in like 3 months. I mean, you, come on, a little higher.
Fine, $100,000.
Nope, stop, higher still.
Come on, you've got $1,000,000 of debt to me.
Very well, I accept your challenge. I happen to have a few Magic and Wizard cards of my own. Not a full deck, you know, I haven't played in a while, so would you be willing to provide a couple for me?
Absolutely.
Here are my cards. You may use whichever ones you like to build your deck.
You have 30 minutes. Go.
That fool! That absolute buffoon! What he doesn't realize are two things. One, I am the regional champion of Magic and Wizards in Nebraska. Two, all of the cards I showed him are pack filler. Trash. They are terrible cards. He can never build a good deck to combat my deck of only ultra-rare cards. He is as good as screwed. Take all the time you want, Mystery Man. You will lose.
All right, Tim Dangle. I have my deck, and I'm ready to duel.
That was quick. Come now, sit down opposite to me, and we can get this game underway. Now, as for how this duel will work, we'll both start with 2,000 life points, and I will go first. Sound good to you?
It sure does.
All right, then. Let's duel! I'll make the first move. I summon Knight in attack mode. Then, I'll place this card face down and end my turn.
It's my turn then. Because I'm going second, I get the first draw. I draw! I'll activate the spell card, Dark Tutor. By paying 1,000 life points, I get to search my deck for any card and put it on top of my deck.
You fool! I activate my face down card. Celtic Counter.
What?
This card negates the effect of your Dark Tutor, but since you already paid the 1,000 life points, you're not getting those back.
Little does Tim know, that move revealed his entire strategy to me. Tim is the kind of player who goes for an aggressive, quick, and flashy victory. The only way I can beat him is if I play slow, methodically, and save my big finish for when the time is most apt. Very well. I set a monster face down and end my turn.
What a pathetic first turn. You lost half your life points and got nowhere. I draw. I summon Celtic Knight in attack mode. And when Celtic Knight is summoned, its effect allows me to add another knight from my deck to my hand. Now, my knight can attack your face-down creature. Unfortunately for you, my set creature is Elf Maiden, who has 2,000 defense points. That's 400 more than your knight has attack points, meaning you'll be dropping to 1,600 life points. You think your high defense points will save you? Knight has a special ability where during the battle phase only, it gains 400 attack. So that's 2,000. And now that Elf Maiden and it have the same exact attack and defense point value, nothing happens this battle phase. I end my turn. It's my turn, and I guess there's nothing left to do except draw. And it's just the card I needed. But first, I'll summon Data Miner.
Data Miner? That's not one of my cards.
I'll perform a tech summon.
A tech summon?
I'll tribute Elf Maiden to tech summon. Meet Tech Spider. When Tech Spider is successfully summoned, I can activate its effect and special summon a no-effect monster from my hand, like this one, Sentient Yeast Puddle. But don't worry, you don't have to get too accustomed to him, because I'm tech summoning again. I use Sentient Yeast Puddle to tech summon Meet Tech Star. But if you think that's all, I'm going to tech summon for a third time. The conditions require two effect creatures. I'm using Tech Star and Tech Spider to tech summon Meet Encrypt Coder. Then I activate the effect of Data Miner to send a tech creature from my extra deck to the graveyard, such as Backup Coder, which allows me to then draw one card. I'll end my turn there.
Only the highest ranking players I know have access to tech creatures, and you're not one of the highest ranking players. Just who are you?
You seriously wonder who I am? I'll tell you exactly who I am, Tim. My name is August. And in 2006, when you released Angels and Airwaves, I was locked up. Locked up in a tiny cube by your mother, Shakira Dangle. For years, 7 years, she tormented me and made me duel constantly. Duel again and again and again. And if I didn't duel, I didn't eat. Meanwhile, you could have done something. You could have helped me, but you didn't. You stood there idly by as myself and five other children dueled for days and days to help playtest this game and make it as perfect and successful as it is now. And now I am going to take my vengeance on you and your family. So, that is to say, if I win, what I want is the location of Shakira Dangle.
Well, I suppose that does explain it. It will be a pleasure to crush you, August.
I draw. And now I'll show you that you're not the only one who can tech summon. I tribute Knight and Celtic Knight to tech summon. Meet Tech Knight.
Now normally, a creature isn't allowed to attack on the turn it summoned, unless I activate a card like this, Haste. I activate Tech Knight's special ability by removing two Knight cards from my hand, field, graveyard, or a combination of the three. I'll choose Infernos Knight from my hand and Celtic Knight from my graveyard. I can destroy a creature on your field, like Data Miner.
What?
And now, Tech Knight, attack and destroy Encrypt Coder. I end my turn.
I activate the effect of Backup Coder in my graveyard. When a coder creature I control was destroyed by battle and sent to the graveyard, I can special summon Backup Coder to my field.
And what good will that do you? Just another useless card in a deck of useless cards.
You may think you have me in a bad spot, but I've got everything I need to come back. I draw. And now, I'm going to activate the spell Rebirth, which allows me to summon a creature from my graveyard. Come on back, Data Miner. And then, I'm going to normal summon Ghost. And now I'm going to perform a tech summon.
What good will that do?
The summoning conditions require three effect creatures, but
backup coder counts as two. So, I'm going to tech summon debug coder. Let me teach you a lesson, Tim, that you are not the only one who has haste in their deck.
What?
I activate haste, targeting debug coder. For every other creature on my field, debug coder gains 300 additional attack points, bringing its total up to 2,800. Now, debug coder, destroy tech knight.
You think you have me on the ropes? You're mistaken. From my hand, I activate the effect of ambush knight. I can special summon this card to my field and negate all the battle damage I would have taken.
If you think your ambush knight is going to save you from damage, let me introduce you to the second effect of debug coder. By tributing a creature on my field, I can negate the special ability of another card on the field and destroy it, such as ambush knight.
What? No!
This means you still take the damage. I end my turn.
It's my turn. I draw.
Just what's so funny?
What's so funny is that I've just drawn the card that will spell your end. I activate Empty the Tomb! Because of the effect of Empty the Tomb, we remove all cards in our graveyard from play. But if you think that's all, you're dead wrong. Because when I have five knights removed from play, I can special summon the most powerful monster in my deck. Come forth, King Arthur! King Arthur has the special ability that if you target a knight for an attack, your creature is automatically destroyed. But I suppose you need a knight to target for an attack first. Then this card will do just fine. I summon Forceful Knight in defense mode. And when Forceful Knight is summoned, I can target a creature on your field and it loses its special abilities, like Debug Coder. It's brilliant. It's perfect. I've got you in an unbeatable combo. And on my next turn, when my King Arthur can attack, you will lose this game. Draw your last useless card, August. I don't care what you do. Summon another useless creature against me, or use another useless spell against me. I have you in a combo, and you will lose. And that is where you are wrong, Tim. You look down on those below you. I know what you did. Your deck is full of ultra-rare cards, and my deck full of only common cards. But I'm going to teach you a little bit about perspective. I draw. Because you see, this deck has no useless cards in it. And I'm going to prove that to you by summoning Cannon Fodder Goblin. Then I'm going to activate the spell card. Reverse Polarity. This card allows me to change the battle position of one creature on your field. And I'm choosing Forceful Knight.
He can't be serious. I mean, everything about that turn was absolutely absurd. First off, he should have used Reverse Polarity to change King Arthur to defense mode. Then he might have had a chance. But he squandered it. He changed Forceful Knight to attack mode. What does he think he can do? Use Cannon Fodder Goblin to attack me, and then bait out Arthur's destruction? Read the damn card, you idiot! Arthur's effect is a May effect. It isn't mandatory, and it happens at my discretion. You've just lost yourself the game. Go ahead, attack with Cannon Fodder Goblin. See if I care.
And now, Debug Coder, attack Forceful Knight. That may not have been the dumbest move you could have made, but it was the second. King Arthur, destroy Debug Coder using your special ability. You thought your combo was perfect,
but you didn't rely on me having a card like Cannon Fodder Goblin. I activate Cannon Fodder Goblin's special ability, which allows me to change it to the target of your effect. So instead of Debug Coder being destroyed, Cannon Fodder Goblin is destroyed.
No.
And with that one small move, that card you called useless won me the game. Debug Coder, attack and destroy. Forceful Knight, ending this game. No! No!
Now tell me where I can find Shakira Dangle.
Fine. She lives at 123 Downing Street. Wait, tell me. How did you beat me?
How? Simple. I read your cards and saw through your strategy. Now, if you'll excuse me.
Tim Dangle, I found you. For so long, you avoided me, and finally, I found you. Not only did I find you, but I beat you. I won at your own game. Now, there's, well, a lot more that stands in the way from me and Shakira. Shakira's many children will be obstacles to get through. There will be many more duels fought, many harder opponents than Tim. But this is one little victory on a long, long path to revenge. Shakira Dangle, I will find you. And now, I've got a clue. I've got one morsel more than I had the day before.